morning. As you're rolling in, everybody's enjoying this cooler fall weather. Well, I fall in. I think we're saying goodbye to some. If you would stand and worship with us this morning. Your song should have arms of love as the first song. Sing a simple song of love to my Savior.
Attendees family, friends, people from the BCNE coming out to support us and everything. So mark your calendars, and if you have any questions about it, you can come talk to Don or I, and we'd be more than happy to talk to you about it. Alright, thank you.
Thank you, Nat. Alright, let's close, continue in a prayer. Thank you.
Are you in a hurry?
It's good to laugh. Father in heaven, we thank you for this day, for this beautiful day that you've given us, Father. We can feel the weather changing, the nice cool breeze, Father. We know that fall is not too far away from us. And we love this season, and we have seasons here in New England. We joke about it. We go from summer to winter with 2 weeks of spring and fall. Lord, this is your beauty. We get to see your power as the leaves will be changing. We will see the glorious colors bursting forth from the rain that we had earlier this year, Father. So we just look forward to seeing that in your beauty and creation. Lord, we ask right now that you would bless us as we continue worshiping and song and studying your word today, Father. Just pray that you would continue to just open our hearts and minds as you mold us and create us into who you want us to be, Father. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Some of these songs are us, they're new to you guys, and just bear with them. They're just songs that God put on my heart. Just we need to just give him all the glory and praise in our lives, and that's kind of where my thought process was this week.
Yeah.
We see the things that God has done. We accept His gift of salvation, and then we have a responsibility to tell others. We have a responsibility to live out our faith. Amen? And that's what this song is talking about. It's just as worshipful to talk about the things we need to do for Christ in our walk with God.
Thank you. We are going to be parked in Daniel chapter 4 today. So last week we began our series on conquering fear. Now fear is an acronym, F.E.A.R. So there's four things there that each one of us as Christians need to work on. Last week was failure. That was the F. Today is ego, or pride. Pride would be more of what I want to call it, but it didn't fit in the acronym. Fear sounds better. And now last week we learned how God uses people who have failed to become rocks of the church. John Mark was, as we discussed, a failure in his mission with Paul and his cousin Barnabas, and still God used him, helped him, strengthened him, and he became fundamental to the beginning of the New Testament canon. Today, we are going, if you can't tell by Daniel, we're going to focus on Nebuchadnezzar. And no one had a bigger ego than Nebuchadnezzar. Ego is something that we all deal with. And it is something that God will use things in our lives to kind of make us think less of ourselves and more on Him. Now, Nebuchadnezzar had it all. And God did stuff in Nebuchadnezzar's life. When we begin the book of Daniel, when we get to chapter 2, he has a dream. And he can't figure out this dream. His magicians and sorcerers can't figure out this dream. And Daniel comes before him and interprets the dream correctly. And Nebuchadnezzar praises God. But then we see he fails. And what does he do? He builds the golden idol. He asks everybody to bow down, and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego don't. And then Nebuchadnezzar says, okay, we're going to put them in the fiery furnace. In that instance, he sees, when he looks in the fiery furnace, he sees a person that he says is like the Son of God's. So God's still trying to get Nebuchadnezzar's attention. I mean, here's a guy that makes an idol of himself to ask everybody to bow down and worship. It takes personal gain over the love of Christ, which is ours to share as Christians. Think about this. In the Bible, we see all sorts of results of pride. Absalom, David's son, whom David loved, that he was to be the crown prince. He was the one that David thought was going to take the crown from him. He had a vanity issue. He grew his hair long. And when he went to civil war with his father, what happened? They were chasing him. And as they chased him, his hair got caught in the tree. And it led to him being killed. The other example we get is that of Satan, Lucifer. The Bible shows us in Isaiah, and Jesus himself talks about it in Luke, that Satan's pride was what took him down. He thought he could be better than God. He was going to put his throne higher than God's. And God struck him down. He took him out of heaven. And we know the ultimate result. In the book of Revelation, it tells us that Satan is going to meet his end. God dislikes pride and arrogance. You know, just look at the Proverbs. They're right there. And he asks us to think about others. Micah 6:8 tells us, The things that God loves is mercy and justice, and to walk humbly with Him. And He promises us also in the Proverbs that we will be rewarded for thinking of others than ourselves. We've all been affected by this, indirectly, but we've been affected. Anyone who's taken the oath of a soldier has been willingly, and many have, died to protect our freedoms here in America. Police officers and firefighters, every day, they don't know you or me, most of these men and women. but they were willing to give up their lives to protect us. And that's two different things. I mean, Jesus did this willingly. He knew who we were going to be. They don't. But we see Christ's example in our soldiers and firefighters and police officers, because they're willing to die for us. So what was this? What is the interpretation of this dream? This is what Daniel tells me. This is going into verse 19. Then Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, was dismayed for a while. And his thoughts alarmed him. The king answered and said, Belteshazzar, let not the dream or the interpretation alarm you. Belteshazzar answered and said, my lord, may the dream be for those who hate you, and its interpretation for your enemies. The tree you saw, which grew and became strong, so that its top reached the heaven, and it was visible to the ends of the earth, whose leaves were beautiful, and its fruit abundant, and in which all food for all, under which beasts of the field found shade, and in whose branches the birds of the heavens lived, it is you, O king, who have grown and become strong. Your greatness has grown and reaches to heaven, and your dominion to the ends of the earth. And because the king saw a watcher, a holy one, come down from heaven, saying, chop down the tree and destroy it, but leave the stump and its roots in the earth, bound with bands of iron and bronze and tender grass, in the tender grass of the field, let him be wet with dew of heaven. Let his portion be with the beasts of the field till the seven periods of time pass on. This is the interpretation, O king. It is a decree of the Most High, which has come upon my lord, the king, that you shall be driven from men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. You shall be made to eat grass like an ox, and you shall be wet with the dew of heaven. And the seven periods of time will pass over you till you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. And as it was commanded to leave the stump of the roots of the tree, your kingdom shall be confirmed to you for the time that you know the heavens rule. Therefore, O king, let my counsel be acceptable to you. Break off of your sins by practicing righteousness, and your iniquities by showing mercy to the oppressed, that there may perhaps be a lengthening of your prosperity. So Daniel is sitting there, and he's trying to tell him, Nebuchadnezzar, God is trying to get your attention once more. You're not in power. God is in power. And so what we studied a few weeks ago when we talked about God puts the president and city councilors, the governors, the kings, every person that rules the earth is in place by God. Whether we like it or not, you're to pray for those people, whether we agree with them or not. And this is an affirmation of this. Like Nebuchadnezzar is this evil, most evil person of times. And God is sitting there trying to get his attention. And Daniel warns him. This is what's going to happen. You're going to be like a beast. You're going to be embarrassed. Your pride is going to fall. Solomon reminds us that pride comes before a fall. That's in Proverbs 16:18. And it's this time where what we're going to see is Nebuchadnezzar comes out on his balcony. And he's looking over everything. Think about this. How many times we've seen this? This is what it says. All this came upon King Nebuchadnezzar. At the end of 12 months, he was walking on the roof of the royal palace of Babylon. And the king answered and said, is not this great Babylon which I have built by my mighty power as a royal residence and for the glory of my majesty? Notice the emphasis. While the words were still in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven. O King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken. The kingdom has departed from you, and you shall be driven from among men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and you shall be made to eat grass like an ox. And 7 periods of time shall pass over you until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. Immediately, the word was fulfilled against Nebuchadnezzar. He was driven out from among the men and ate grass like an ox, and his body was wet with dew, with the dew of heaven, till his hair grew as long as eagle's feathers, and his nails were like bird's claws. So think of this. Think of it. Here it is, the mighty King Nebuchadnezzar, very feared man, very powerful man. When you read the Bible, when you look at history, how history talks about him, and yet now he's embarrassed. His hair grows, and it's like eagle's feathers. I don't know if you've ever seen like a wet bird, a wet eagle, but the feathers, they just get kind of nasty, kind of gnat. And the claws, I wish we had, we're going to have our projector next week. I wish we had it because I saw this beautiful picture that would have just shown you where the park rangers had some of the birds, some of the falcons and eagles that they're trying to get out of the hurricane area that are in the zoos. And one of them was holding the eagle's talons, you know, holding the feet. And you could see the talons, and the talons looked like this, like they were, well, I can't twist this. They were almost like that, probably from here to here. As he was holding the hand, you could see these razor sharp talons. So that gives you an idea of how long Nebuchadnezzar's fingernails were getting. Now they've got, and there is like this woman, I don't know if you've ever seen it, she's like, just drew her nails like ridiculously long, like I can't even like describe it, but they're all just bent and misshapen and stuff. But Nebuchadnezzar is driven, like he's made to look like the homeless man and worse. And he's eating grass, so people are thinking he's crazy. They put him in a pen, and you can just imagine, like the people are walking by and they're like, hey, Ben, isn't that the king? I don't know. They're sitting there, they're trying to figure this out. God has taken the pride and arrogance of Nebuchadnezzar and just bashed it. And why? It's because God is trying to show him, you didn't do. You notice the words he uses, you know, my power, my might. And what did Daniel say? Daniel told him, you are here because of God the Most High. So God is now using this time to get to Nebuchadnezzar. I remember how God basically got me on something. Natalie and I will be celebrating 19 years in Tuesday of marriage. And we've been pregnant only once. And as we've struggled and everything, we went to the doctors, and the doctors told us it is very unlikely you'll have children of your own. It's just, you had the one time, and even that was a long shot. Now, I believe in God. I believe if God wants to open Natalie's womb, so be it. And I held on to that for the longest time. I said to myself, if we're going to have kids, it's going to be my own project. You know, somebody's going to carry on the McKinnon name, they're going to be McKinnon blood. Well, God had other things. And so Natalie was looking at adoption. She looked at the possibility of adoption. And I was like, no, I don't want to adopt. I could never love anybody who's not my own. Well, God had a different purpose. God had a different thing to show me. What did he show me? Well, Natalie's best friend Rachel and her ex-husband had to have two kids. And we were made the godparents of them. And when they went through this bitter divorce, neither one could, as they say today, neither one could parent. And they just were so messed up with things going on in their lives that they knew they had to do something with their kids. And so they came to us, they went to DCF, and they said, we want Don and Natalie to be the custodial guardians of the kids until one of us can take them back. So during that time that we were basically their parents, it went beyond, you know, just this pride of being, oh, this is my godchild, you know, I gotta go to my godchild. I started to realize God was changing my heart. The pride and arrogance that I could only love a kid that was my own disappeared, because I realized that if anything happened to these two, Hunter and Mia, I would, if somebody broke in the door, I was willing to die for them. Just as their own parents would. Just as God is willing to do. And I realized at that time, okay, I can do this. And then my father told me, well, you do know that your great-grandfather on your grandmother's side was adopted. And then I found out Natalie's grandfather was adopted and her mother was adopted. It doesn't change who they were to me. They're still family. They're still parents and grandparents and great-grandparents. They still lived and they still shaped who their children were, who helped shape me. And so that's where God worked on my pride. And so Natalie and I, last year, we started the process of adoption. We started going through the process to get the okay so that we can adopt. That's how God does things. He does things to make us better. He can take things away from us, which makes us more dependent on Him and less independent with ourselves. It says John the Baptist said, he said, as his ministry had to come to an end and Jesus' ministry was beginning, he must increase while I must decrease. So what happens? What happened to Nebuchadnezzar? Well, if you notice, he is the one writing this chapter. So, this is what it says. This is how it ends. It says, at the end of the days, this is verse 34, at the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my reason returned to me, and I blessed the Most High, and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are counted as nothing, and he does according to his will among the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what have you done? At that time my reason returned to me, and for the glory of my kingdom, my majesty and splendor returned to me. My counselors and my lords sought me, and I was established in my kingdom, and still more greatness was added to me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of Heaven, for all his works are right and his ways are just, and those who walk in pride he is able to humble. That last sentence, those who walk in pride he is able to humble. Nebuchadnezzar has gone through the whole time that God has set aside, and he blesses, and he cries out to God, and it's this beautiful poem, this beautiful prayer, this beautiful song, whatever you want to say. If you notice in your Bibles, it's got a little indentation, probably, if you've got like a New American Standard or an ESV, because it's just showing you that this is something that's different. And this is why I believe Daniel let Nebuchadnezzar write this and put this into his book, because God humbled the great king of the time, the greatest king of the time. He understood now. You notice his language changed. He went from talking about gods with a small g and in a plural sense, to God Most High with a capital G and in a singular sense. Now God's got his attention. After all those times, after seeing God work in so many miraculous ways, it took him becoming an animal for God to finally make sense to Nebuchadnezzar. Pride comes before a fall. And God will do things. Sometimes it doesn't make sense, but we know from what Nebuchadnezzar says here, it's just. God takes those things away because sometimes we're just giving him a percentage of our attention. And God doesn't want a percentage, he wants it all. Well, how do we do it all? How do we give God our all when we're trying to live and work and raise families and all this stuff? And it can happen. It does happen. We've got this book which shows us many people that did it. It's a balance. It's realizing that God is central to our lives. Ego says that we are the center of the world and that our family and friends are the planets around us. We are the sun, and our family and friends are the planets circulating around us. But a life centered on God says that God is the most important. It doesn't put things in place of God. We still have our family, our friends, our careers, our hobbies, all those things that make us who we are. But it's taking more time. It's realizing that we have to be in the Bible every day. We have to be praying. There are churches out there today that say, you don't have to be reading the Bible every day. You don't have to be praying every day. That's bunk. If we look at the example of Jesus, we see that he made the time. He would sit there, he would be talking with the disciples and preaching to the people, and then it says he would make time to go in silence and pray. Daniel, when you read the book of Daniel, he prayed three times. He made the time three times a day to pray. Even after the decree came out and said, you shouldn't be praying anymore, he still prayed. It's taking those things and taking the time to read and pray, to drown out the voices that might be stroking our egos, that make us focus less on God and more on ourselves, instead of vice versa, less on ourselves and more on God. It helps us to rethink our decisions. Are we doing what's honoring to God, or are we doing something that's going to make us more important to others? Ego makes us our own God, little g, and takes God, big G, out of the picture. We can become so fascinated with all the stuff that we're doing, with what's on YouTube and Netflix and other things. We make those into our gods. We become so fascinated with what's there. we don't make the time to read or pray every day. And that's the controls to ego. Reading the Bible and praying. Paul tells us in 1 Thessalonians, pray without ceasing, in all your ways acknowledge God. That means God is central to a Christian's life. It takes work, but it can be done. So what's the application? How do we get there? There's a simple thing that I heard a few years ago. And it was something that I needed to work on because my prayer life wasn't where it should be. And what it was it said, just take 5 minutes out of your schedule to pray. Take 5 minutes out of your schedule to read. Do that every day. Take 5 minutes. What happens? Psychologists have found out that if we do something every day for 40 days, it becomes a habit. So, whatever you're trying to do, you know, if you're trying to practice guitar, some people after last week would say yes. It's taking 5 minutes to just strum and make sure that I'm doing the correct finger patterns on the neck of the guitar. And then that time grows. But as those 40 days happen, now it's become part of my psyche. Like now my mind sits there and says, oh yeah, I gotta go practice. And so I go and I pick up the guitar and I strum and I practice and I play. It's the same thing with prayer and reading the Bible. You don't have to get deep in it at first. You can just read. There are things that God is going to speak. The Holy Spirit will speak to you, even in those 5 minutes. And then that 5 minutes turns into 10. And then 15 and 20 and 25 and a half hour. And soon you know you have an hour of prayer and reading. And you feel better. And you're less focused about who you are and more focused about who God is and what you can do to honor God, what you can do to help God. God wants to connect with. He wants to connect with all of us. We have to remember that we are in a relationship with God. That's what it is. You've probably all seen the t-shirts or the posters that say religion, you know, is this, but Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. And think about it. If you've ever been married, I know of one person that hasn't been married yet in this room. But in relationships, you work on your marriage. You work to spend time with your spouse. And if you don't, what happens? That relationship goes south. You get into arguments. Sadly, in this day and age, it becomes a common occurrence to see relationships not get worked on because divorce is too easy to apply for. And it's the same thing with God. God wants us in that relationship. He wants us to be working on that relationship. Well, how do we work on that relationship? How do we become less and God becomes more? How do we take the ego and the pride aside and focus more on God in our relationship? It's taking time to read the Word of God, to understand. He's going to speak to us through. And then how do we speak to him? We're praying to him. That's how it works. We pray and we read. And that's how our relationships with God become stronger. You know, I brought this up. I normally don't, but Scott chose All I Am as one of the songs today. It's like, you know, take this heart, set it on fire. I want to tell the world of who you are, all I am is yours. I give you all my life, I'm letting it go. I live in sacrifice, no longer my own. That's taking the pride and throwing it aside and living for God. So today, that's your challenge. If you're doing great. I'm happy for you. I know I struggle at times. There are days where work and other things happen. Like last night, I'm trying to get prepared for today, and my phone decides to stop working. And I'm sitting there, like, so focused on it. And Natalie has to sit there and say, you know what? Just relax. Just relax. This is Satan trying to get you off your mind for church in the morning. So I had to just put it aside. I still had the alarm clock. It still woke me up. It's still like an iPod. I can listen to songs and stuff on the way in. But if you tried to message me, I couldn't get your messages today. But it's those things that God uses to get our focus. What happened? We're coming in and I'm listening to a sermon from another pastor, and I'm like, wow, that's really good stuff. And then I realize that's God talking to me. It's not the pastor talking to me. It's the message that God gave that pastor to speak, and I just happened to be listening to it, and it just happened to be what I needed as I was coming in to prepare for this. And that's the way God does. He will take things aside, take things away, because he wants your attention. Let's go to prayer. Father in heaven, well, we come before you now. And Father, I just pray that where we all are, that we will just focus on you. It becomes a struggle. The enemy doesn't want us to focus on you. The enemy will do things to just get our minds off of you and who you are. And Father, we want to serve you. We want to be your children. We want to just grow. We don't want what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. I know that is in a far extreme because you had to use extreme measures on him. But there are ways that you try to grab our attention. And Father, I just pray that you would just help us this week. Help us to focus. Father, for those that are working on their relationship with you, that read and pray daily, Father, I just thank you for them. For those that need to work on that time, Father, I just pray that you would help them. Take that 5 minutes each day for prayer and 5 minutes for reading and just help that to grow, Father, for them. Speak to them and love them. Father, I just pray that you would take this offering that we are going to give, Father. Bless it, Father. Bless it for the work of this church. Father, I pray that you would give all of us safety, mercies, home, Father, and back again next Sunday. I pray that you just hold us in your arms whenever we're going through tough times. Because you do love us. You are a holy and loving and just God, and we do call you Abba, Father. So we just pray and ask, Father, for all this to be done. In Jesus' precious holy name, amen.
This is Jeff, Pastor the play. We're going to sing one last song. And can you put the words in there, too? Feel free at this time, too, while this song is being played. I know that back in the day, everybody had altar calls and people could come up and pray. And you know, that's a time that we set aside any time in our life. But if specifically this morning, like for me, I'll be praying as I sing. But if specifically this morning there's something on your heart where you just want to come forward or pray at your seat even, just think of the words of the song.
Oh, come to
dismissed.